nobis Domine misericordiam tuam.
Yes,
Misericordiae vesti omnipotens Deus et dimissis peccatis vestis producat vostra vitam aeternam. Indulgentiam absolutionem et remissionem peccatorum nostrum derivo ad nobis omnipotens et misericordios Dominus. Deus tu conversus et abis nos. Ostende nobis Domine misericordiam tuam. Domine exaudi ratione meam. Dominus vobiscum. Oremus.
Amen.
Dominus vobis cum. Oremus, omnipotens et sempiterne Deus, in fiumitate nostra propitius respice, atque potestiendo nos dextram tua maestatis extende, per Dominum nostrum Iesum Christum filium tuum, qui te convivite regnat in unitate Spiritus Sancti Deus, per omnia saecula saeculorum. Lectio epistle beati Pauli apostoli ad Romanos. Frades non litis de prudentes apophos metipsos, nulli malum pro malore gentes. Provinis panna non tantum coram Deo, sed etiam coram omnibus hominibus. Si fiere potes quae ex vobis est cum omnibus hominibus pacem habentes, non ad vos venimus defentes carissimi, sed date locum ire. Scritum est indicita, ego recipo vam dicit Dominus. Sensius eriut inimicus tuus civa illum, sicili tot pausum dat iniogeni facens carbonis nis congere super caput eius. Noli vinciam malo, fese vincin bonum malum. Dominus vobis cum.
Et spiritus tuo.
Sequentia Sancti Evangelii secundum Matteum.
Gloria tibi Domine.
In illo tempore, unde scenis e Iesus de monte, securit un eum turbe multe legere prosus venians autorabat eum dicens, Dominus sibis potes me mune dare. Et extendens Iesus manum tecit eum dicens, volo, mundare, et confessim mundates lepra eius, et aiit illi Iesus, vide nemine dixeris, et vade ostinite sacerdoti offermulus, quod precipi Moises in testimonium illis. cum ad indovise Capernaum, Cesareum, Centurio, Rogans, eum et dicens. Domine povero meus, iatine in padomo paralyticus, et maletor quaetum. Et aiet illi esso, ego veniam et curabo eum. Et respondent centurio aed, Domine non sum dignitur intre subtectum meum, sed tantum nifeo et sanabitur puer meum. Namen ego homus sum potestate constitutus et habent sum milites et ico hoc, varie paridati veni et venid, et servum meo fac hoc et facit. Audis eis adem Iesus miratus est esse quentibus edixit, amen digo vobis non veni tantam filem in Israel. Dico autem vobis, quod multi ab oriente et occidente venire et recumbecum Abraham et Isaac et Jacob in regno celorum, filiatim regni cientum in tenebras exteriores, ibi erit fredus estrido tensium. Et dice Iesus centurioni, vale sigo credilisti fiat et tibi, et sanatus est puer in illa ora.
Today is the third Sunday after the Epiphany, and the epistle is taken from the letter of the Apostle St. Paul to the Romans. Brethren, be not wise in your own conceits, to no man rendering evil for evil, providing good things, not only in the sight of God, but also in the sight of all men. If it be possible, as much as is in you, having peace with all men, not revenging yourselves, my dearly beloved, but give place unto wrath, for it is written, revenge is mine, I will repay, saith the Lord. But if thy enemy be hungry, give him to eat. If he thirst, give him to drink. For doing this, thou shalt heap coals of fire upon his head. Be not overcome by evil, but overcome evil by good. And the Holy Gospel is taken from the Gospel according to St. Matthew. At that time, when Jesus was come down from the mountain, great multitudes followed him. And behold, a leper came and adored him, saying, Lord, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. And Jesus, stretching forth his hand, touched him, saying, I will. Be thou made clean. And forthwith his leprosy was cleansed. And Jesus saith to him, See thou tell no man, but go, show thyself to the priest, and offer the gift which Moses commanded for a testimony unto them. And when he had entered into Capernaum, there came to him a centurion, beseeching him and saying, Lord, my servant lieth at home sick of the palsy, and is grievously tormented. And Jesus saith to him, I will come and heal him. And the centurion making answer said, Lord, I am not worthy that thou wouldst enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my servant shall be healed. For I also am a man subject to authority, having under me soldiers. And I say to this man, go, and he goeth, and to another, come, and he cometh, and to my servant, do this, and he doeth it. And Jesus, hearing this, marveled and said to them that followed him, Amen, I say to you, I have not found so great faith in Israel. And I say to you, that many shall come from the east and the west, and shall sit down with Abraham and Isaac and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. But the children of the kingdom shall be cast out into the exterior darkness. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. And Jesus said to the centurion, Go, and as thou hast believed, so be it done to thee. And the servant was healed at the same hour. Just a couple of announcements. As you know, we have already started our catechism program, and all the children are expected to be in catechism classes, 8:45, and of course the adults' class is in the parish hall at the same time. The results for the Eucharistic Crusade for last month were deplorable. They're in the bulletin. I only received 4 treasure sheets. Kept waiting, hoping to get some more. Hopefully this month of January, we'll have a better result from the children. More sacrifices, more prayers, which help greatly Holy Mother the Church, especially this month, for which the special intention is to console the Sacred Heart of Jesus. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, Amen. Lord, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. Lord, my servant layeth at home with the palsy. We had in today's gospel 2 prayers, very brief prayers, very simple prayers, but very beautiful prayers, which, because they had the qualities necessary for prayer, were answered by our divine Savior. The leper simply states the reality with great confidence in his heart. Lord, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. A prayer, not forcing God's hand, as it were, stating, admitting our need, God's power, the divinity of Christ, his ability to cure. The leper had great confidence. And confidence is the first quality the prayer must have. Because we have faith that God is God. Then we know. We have the assurance that he can answer our prayers. And that when Jesus said these words, he meant it. Ask and you shall receive. Seek and you shall find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you. Confidence is fundamental. Every time that a prayer in the gospel is answered, it's because the person who prays, prays with great confidence. We see confidence also in the centurion, who simply states the fact, my servant boy is lying at home paralyzed in bed. Our Lord understood immediately the request. Come and heal him. With confidence, so Jesus offers to come. And that's when the centurion says another prayer. A prayer filled with the second quality that all our prayers must have. Humility. Sense of our unworthiness. That things are not owed to us. That God's graces and blessings are not owed to us and we don't deserve them. And he says, Lord, I'm not worthy that thou hast come under my roof. Just say the word, and my servant shall be healed. Beautiful prayer, because it expresses great humility in this centurion, this man of honor who has 100 soldiers under him, who a leader of men, who has authority, and yet great humility at the same time. before Almighty God. We find there a second quality that all our prayers must have. That when we beg graces of God, we know that they are not owed to us and we do not deserve them and we are unworthy and we have to admit that first. Or we can't be beggars of the divine mercy. Now there's a third quality that Saint Bernard points out. That our prayers must have, if they are to be fruitful, they must be fervent, coming from the depth of our hearts, with that longing and desire for the graces that we beg, with that sense of dependence upon Almighty God, not tepid, lukewarm, indifferent, but we have to really want and desire from the depth of our hearts, inasmuch as it's God's holy will, what we pray for. You know, and you've heard, I'm sure, the words of our divine Savior to the Bishop of the Church of Laodicea, which are recorded in the book of the Apocalypse, in which he condemns that church because of its lukewarmness, lack of desire, longing for God's graces and blessings. Because you are lukewarm and neither hot nor cold, I will begin to vomit you out of my mouth. Because you say I'm rich and wealthy and have no need of anything, and do not understand that you are poor, wretched, naked, blind, and lame. He states the facts. The lukewarm don't understand their emptiness, their wretchedness, their littleness, and so they don't pray with fervor. And that's why it is that our Lord prefers the cold of the heart to the lukewarm who are indifferent. The cold, they know that we're sinners and they beg for God's grace, the grace of conversion. It's desperately needed. They beg it and they'll receive it and their prayers will be answered. The hot, the fervent pray with fervor. The cold and the hot pray with fervor. The lukewarm don't care. Most of our prayers, alas, are lukewarm. And that's why we find, so often, we don't receive the answers that we want. And that, is, of course, is a common objection to the power of prayer. The things I ask for, I never get them, we hear people say. Due, as it is, to a profound misunderstanding of the nature of prayer and of the place of prayer in God's plan. Let's put prayer into its true perspective. It's an act of the virtue of religion. There are two principal interior acts of religion that we must practice. First is devotion. Second is prayer. We have to be devoted to Almighty God, which means we have to acknowledge that we're His. We belong to Him. We belong to our divine Savior. We belong to the Blessed Virgin Mary. Devotion is fundamental. And devotion is nourished by meditation on divine truths, on reflecting on supernatural realities and the truths of our faith. And the more we pray upon them and reflect upon them, then the more devotion we'll have in our hearts. So the first kind of prayer raising the mind up to God is meditation, which encourages devotion and fuels the love in our hearts so that we care about the things of God. It's only afterwards we come to the other kinds of prayer, which is a consequence of devotion. Is if we are devoted to Almighty God and long for God's will to be accomplished, then we'll pray for the other things we need to pray for. But before we get to the prayer of petition, our favorite, we need to make our favorites, first of all, the prayers of praise of Almighty God and of thanksgiving. We have to praise God for who He is. The prayers of the Mass. the prayers of the Gloria, the Mass, beautiful prayer of praise. We must honor God for who He is first. And then we must thank Him for His blessings, and thank Him for the grace He's given to us, and thank Him for the life, and thank Him for the sun and the day that He's given to us, thanking Him for the love of God, thanking Him that we're able to pray. There's so many things we must thank God for constantly. We only come to the prayer of petition, asking for what we need, after the prayer of praise and thanksgiving, after the meditation, and after our devotion to the things of God. The correct order is fundamental. In the prayers that we just heard in the Gospel, those very brief prayers, the correct order was observed. The leper adored Christ first. The centurion acknowledged His divinity first. And so must we do. But when it comes to the prayer of petition, there must be an order in our petitions also. We must ask for the most important things first. And the most important things are supernatural things. The needs of our soul. The graces that we need to love God. Conversion, contrition for our sins. And these graces we will receive inasmuch as we meditate upon divine truths. Because they have to come first. And if we think of how God has been good to us, we think of how much God has loved us and helped us throughout our life, we'll have gratitude in our hearts. If we think of what Jesus did, God the Son dying upon the cross, how much He suffered for us, paying the debt of our sins, we will have gratitude in our hearts, we'll have praise in our lips. And then we can pray for the things that we need, not the things that we want, the things that we need, according to God's plan. Many people think that prayer is a way of twisting God's arm to get Him to want what we want, to go along with what our desires are. As if we could in some way change God, who is immutable, unchangeable in Himself and also in His plan of providence, which never changes. No, prayer doesn't change God. The role of prayer is in God's plan of providence. He wants things to happen, good things to happen, graces to be given, temptations to be overcome through the prayers that we ourselves make, prayers by which we cooperate with God's grace. And it's through that means that we receive graces. So prayer is the channel by which, in God's plan, we are to receive the blessings that we need. If we don't pray, we don't receive them. If we do pray, God's plan is accomplished. We receive them. And which blessings then? First of all, the blessings that our soul needs, which we must pray for first. Our great faith, love of God, true sorrow for our sins, forgiveness of our enemies, patience, virtues that we need to carry our cross every day. We pray for those first and foremost because we know they are God's will. And we know that our prayer will be infallibly answered because we're praying for something which we know to be God's will. He just wants us to pray for those graces to receive them. He wants us to be, by our prayers, the instrument of the fulfillment of His plan for the sanctification of our souls and the souls of others. There's the beauty of prayer as it fits into God's plan. After having requested those graces that we need for our souls, we then ask for the temporal needs of our day-to-day life. And these we must pray for. We have the duty to pray for them because they depend upon Almighty God, the Creator. And those helps that He gives us, food, home, clothing, friends, support, income, work, business, all of these things are good in themselves. And we must pray for them in as much as it is God's will for us to have them. Remembering that we don't pray for what we want, what we desire, we pray for what we need in God's plan. Knowing that He knows much better than us, with His divine wisdom, what we need. And He obtains for us and gives us all the things that we need. And that's where there's a test of our confidence and our humility and our fervor in our prayers. And very frequently, the good Lord makes us wait. And sometimes makes us wait a long time to have our prayers answered. Oftentimes they're not answered the way that we want when it concerns temporal things. They're answered the way He wants. But they're still answered. Now, if God makes us wait, it's to teach us a lesson. It's to teach us that prayer is the expression of our dependence upon Almighty God, our acknowledgement of His supreme dominion over the whole of creation, our submission to His holy will that we want to accomplish, our recognition that nothing is worth anything unless it is according to the will of the Almighty, so that we can fulfill His plan perfectly. And for that, oftentimes, we must wait. We must wait, and God will answer our prayers as He sees fit. We must then, at these moments of great confidence, hope in His mercy, in His goodness and love, great humility, acknowledging that nothing is owed to us because we're sinners, and fervor in understanding that we're begging from one who has total control. We're begging as those who truly are in need. Our divine Savior deigned to teach us the perfect prayer. When His apostles asked Him to teach them how to pray, He told them, you know it so well. We say it all the time, constantly, the Our Father. And why is it a perfect prayer? Because it teaches us what things we have to ask for and in what order we must ask for them. And you notice that first of all, our first goal is the honor and glory of Almighty God. Hallowed be Thy name. First thing we pray for doesn't concern ourselves. It's the honor and glory and praise of Almighty God, which we beg be accomplished here upon this earth as it is in heaven. And then we pray that His kingdom come, the kingdom of grace on this earth by which souls are transformed, the kingdom of God in our own hearts and souls, which is the preparation for heaven. We're praying then for heaven for our own selves, prepared as it is on this earth. It's our goal. And we pray for that first and foremost. It's not something owed to us. It's not something due to us. The grace of final perseverance is the greatest of all graces. We must pray for it and beg for it. And it's what we're praying for when we say, Thy kingdom come. Then, the means. How are we going to get to heaven? How are we going to promote the honor and glory of Almighty God? The means, God's will, that His will be accomplished, and that we all cooperate in the fulfillment of God's holy will. Thy will be done, we pray. That God's will be done in our own hearts, in our actions, in our words, and around us, not just in us, but all around us, because that's the source of peace and harmony and unity and virtue and goodness. Is God's will being accomplished. It's the means for His kingdom to be accomplished upon this earth. Then we pray for what we need on this earth to accomplish God's will. Give us this day our daily bread. our super substantial bread, as St. Luke says, the Holy Eucharist, the bread of life, which nourishes our souls with the love of God, and also our physical necessities are contained in our daily bread. What God knows that we need, we pray for, according to His holy will. Because we've already submitted ourselves to God's will when we pray for our daily bread. And then, we pray that God might remove the obstacles to us attaining our goal, which is heaven. Our sins, our trespasses, that's the obstacle. So we pray that they be removed from our souls. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And then, we pray that we might be delivered from that other obstacle that the devil places in our path to try and destroy us, destroy our souls, and to destroy the life of grace in our souls. Lead us not into temptation. That is, do not allow us to fall into the temptations which surround us, those temptations which come upon us, even when we're in prayer sometimes. And so we beg Almighty God to preserve us from that, because we know our weakness, we know our human nature is frail and has this tendency towards evil. So we beg to be protected from temptation and delivered from evil. Then we have the perfect prayer, which expresses all the things we must ask of Almighty God in the right place, in God's plan. The divine office, the Mass, and the Rosary are the three most perfect prayers that there are, because they fulfill this plan in the right and due order. The Mass is a perfect prayer because, first of all, gives praise and adoration to Almighty God, thanksgiving for His blessings, and then offers a sacrifice for our sins. And we can ask for all the graces, the blessings we need as we assist in Mass. The divine office, which is the office of the Church, which is based upon the Psalms, hymns of praise and thanksgiving to Almighty God, first and foremost, before we ask for the graces we need. And likewise, the Rosary, which you say every day, the form of the divine office for the lay people that everybody can say. Why is it such a powerful prayer? Why does it accomplish so much? Why is it so often answered? Not because we're asking for A, B, or C, or this, that, or the other thing. Because first and foremost, we repeat the two most beautiful prayers, the Our Father and the Hail Mary. The Hail Mary, which honors the mystery of the Incarnation. The Our Father, which is Jesus' prayer that He taught us to say. And we meditate upon the principal mysteries, upon which and from which all graces flow, the Incarnation, the Redemption, and everlasting life. And so we have here the source of all the graces that come from the Rosary because of what we're meditating and reflecting upon. We don't spend the bulk of our time when we say our Rosary asking for one or other special intention. We spend the bulk of our time meditating upon these mysteries of our faith and thanking God for who He is and for His blessings and for His Son who died upon the cross for us. And we praise Him and thank Him for that as we go through our Rosary. We are prepared. Our souls are prepared. Our souls then have full confidence, true humility and fervor, and we're out to pray for the graces we need. And that's why it is that the Rosary, as given to us by the Blessed Virgin Mary through St. Dominic, is such a powerful prayer. It's likewise the reason why the saints' prayers are answered, whether they be saints on this earth or saints who have passed to heaven and whom we beseech to pray on our behalf. Why are their prayers so powerful? Because they put God first. Their devotion, they have in their hearts that longing for God's honor and glory and thanksgiving. And so their prayers are powerful. And that's the moral of the story of these prayers in the gospel as the prayers of the saints, that we must follow their example. Yes, have confidence, have humility, have fervor in our prayers, but remember, first of all, devotion. First of all, meditation on divine truths. First of all, God's praise and honor and glory and thanksgiving. And then we'll be able to imitate the Blessed Virgin Mary, whose Magnificat is the most perfect prayer that a creature ever uttered. My soul doth magnify the Lord, and my spirit hath rejoiced in God my Savior, because he has regarded the lowliness of his handmaid. For behold, from henceforth all generations shall call me blessed, for he that is mighty hath done great things to me, and holy is his name. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, amen.
Hey.
our Opera Domini.
Yes. Oh,
peccatoribus.
In omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Aveus praeceptis salutaribus omniti, et divini solutione formatia demus dicere. Pater noster qui es in celis, sanctificetur nomen tuum, aveniat regnum tuum, fiat voluntas tua, sicut in cielo et in terra. Panem nostrum quotidianum da nobis hodie, et dimitte nobis debita nostra, sicut et nos dimittimus debitoribus nostris, et ne nos inducas in tentationem. Omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Pax Domini sit semper vobiscum.
Domini non mi sentite. Domine non sum dignus. Domine non sum dignus.
Miseriado vesti omnipotens Deus et dimissus peccatis vestis perducat vos ad vitam aeternam. Indulgentiam absolutionem et remissionem et peccatorum vesto juntiva vobis omnipotens et misericos Dominus. Ecce agnus Dei, ecce quietudi de peccato mundi. Domine non sum dignus surintae subtectum meum, sed tanto dic verbo est in habitu anima mea. Domine non sum dignus surintae subtectum meum, sed tanto dic verbo est in habitu anima mea. Domine non sum dignus surintae subtectum meum, sed tatu dic verbo est in habitu anima mea.
Corpus Domini nostri Jesu Christi, custodia d'animam tua, in vita eterna. Corpus Domini nostri Jesu Christi, custodia d'animam tua, in vita eterna. Corpus Domini nostri Jesu Christi, custodia d'animam tua, in vita eterna. Corpus Domini nostri Jesu Christi, custodia d'animam tua, in vita eterna. Corpus Domini nostri Jesu Christi, custodia d'animam tua, in vita eterna. Corpus Domini nostri Jesu Christi, custodia d'animam tua, in vita eterna. Corpus Domini nostri Jesu Christi, custodia d'animam tua, in vita eterna. Corpus Domini nostri Jesu Christi, custodia d'animam tua, in vita eterna. Corpus Domini nostri Jesu Christi, custodia d'animam tua, in vita eterna. Corpus Domini nostri Jesu Christi, custodia d'animam tua, in vita eterna. Corpus Domini nostri Jesu Christi, custodia d'animam tua, in vita eterna. Corpus Domini nostri Jesu Christi, custodia d'animam tua, in vita eterna. Corpus Domini nostri Jesu Christi, custodia d'animam tua, in vita eterna. Opus Domini Jesu Christi, custodia tenim tuum in vita. Opus Domini Jesu Christi, custodia tenim tuum in vita. Opus Domini Jesu Christi, custodia tenim tuum in vita. Opus Domini Jesu Christi, custodia tenim tuum in vita. Opus Domini Jesu Christi, custodia tenim tuum in vita. Opus Domini Jesu Christi, custodia tenim tuum in vita. Opus Domini Jesu Christi, custodia tenim tuum in vita. Opus Domini Jesu Christi, custodia tenim tuum in vita. Opus Domini Jesu Christi, custodia tenim tuum in vita. Opus Domini Jesu Christi, custodia tenim tuum in vita. Opus Domini Jesu Christi, custodia tenim tuum in vita. Opus Domini Jesu Christi, custodia tenim tuum in vita. Opus Domini Jesu Christi, custodia tenim tuum in vita.
Thank you.
Nella banda omne te che si croce le batte o fredde.
Dominus Provis Cum. Alemu. Postantis Domini legiri tutti misteris. Coesum. Ole fedibus nos eunum verace lepta redigeris. Per Dominum nostrum Iesum Christum filium tuum, qui tecum vivit et regnat in unitate Spiritus Sancti Deus, per omnia saecula saeculorum. Dominus vobis cum.
Benedicat vos omnipotens Deus, Pater et Filius et Spiritus Sanctus. Dominus vobiscum. Initium Sancti Evangelii secundum Ioannem. In principio erat verbum, et verbum erat ab Deum, et Deus erat verbum, hoc erat in principio ab Deum, omnia verit, sustumus sinistra partem est, non dico partem est. In ipso vide erat lux omnem, lux in tenebris, lucere tenebrae, eum non comprehendem mundum. Quid homo mystus ad Deo cui nomen erat Ioannes, qui venit in testimonium, et testimonia benedicat et lumine aut omnes, credere in peillum. Non erat erebus, ero testimonia benedicat et lumine. Erat lux vera, quia illuminat omnem hominem venitem in ubo mundum. In mundo erat, in mundus benedictum, patus est in mundus, eum non coniovitem. In propria venitet sui, eum non receperunt. Coagulate neceperum deum deri Deus paristare in fili ossa Dei, figli, ispi credo di nomine e sui nonni sanguinibus, nebis volontate carnis, nebis volontate divini, serecte un natistum. El vero bon caro factum est, ed abitabit in nobis e vidimus, gloria meus, gloria in quasi unigenitia, pate, venum quasi et veritatis. Amen.